message this morning. It's called Right or Relationship. It is the question that we begin with. It is the question that we will end with. Right or relationship? I've got a few scenarios I want to run past you. And I would like you to hold your answer to yourself. Because in each one of these scenarios, you're very likely to fall on one side or the other. In the church, we have people who make up the church that come from different backgrounds. And some people see something from over here, and some people see it over here, and one may be right, and one may be wrong, but there's room for all to grow, and there's grace for everybody. But what I want to give you these scenarios for is that you think about them as we go through the scriptures. Scenario number one. A man and a woman get married. They're young, they're in their 20s. And it didn't seem like an issue at the time, but after they got married and the stresses of life began to build and they began to have children, the drinking became more of an issue. And this young couple, so in love, they got married, but the alcohol was becoming a dividing factor for the marriage. Well, she did the right thing. She went to church, she began to grow in Christ, and then she began to pray for her husband to come to church. One day he did. She talked to him about the alcohol and how he was dividing the family and how he was perhaps not physically abusive, but certainly mentally. He finally came to church and he was so uncomfortable, and as he sat there, the pastor was teaching on a message and he touched on alcohol. But not in the way you think he might. You see, the pastor had fully believed he has a Christian liberty to drink. And because of this liberty, he shared it with the congregation, and he built a biblical case on why he has the liberty to drink. It's not an issue in his life. And in fact, Jesus did turn water into wine, and so he sort of validated and justified his drinking to everybody. Was he right? Perhaps. But the man who came to church with his wife heard that, felt completely justified in his drinking, and found out that the pastor drank and said to his wife, "This is a bunch of hypocrisy. I don't want to have anything to do with it." He never came back. He further went down to the line of alcohol. Destroyed his family. Scenario number two. Another young family. Husband, a wife, three kids. This family had been raised in a different kind of church growing up. A church where rules and regulations were of the utmost importance. In fact, raised up even to the very limit of Scripture itself. There were a lot of rules. It was hard to keep. But when you did keep the rules, you found a certain righteousness and you found a certain holiness. And they were keeping these rules and, in fact, even began to look down on other people around them that didn't keep the rules, so they were a lower form of Christian or perhaps not a Christian itself. One of the rules was not ever to even come close to alcohol. They believed that there was a demon in the alcohol itself. And if the bottle was open, the demon escaped and caused problems. They believed it so much so that when she was invited to her best friend's wedding, and in fact even asked to be in the wedding party, she said she would only come if there was no drinking. Well, that wasn't really going to be possible, but because she wanted her best friend to be a part of the wedding and they'd grown up together and they had been so close, she brought her and said, "Well, maybe you can just hang out until the alcohol starts." And the wedding went on and things happened, but as soon as everybody sat down to eat, before they even got there, she heard a beer can open. She angrily gathered up her children, got her husband, and stormed out in front of everybody. Her friend said, "What are you doing? You're ruining my wedding." She turned and looked at her and said, "I will not be around anywhere that there's an open container of alcohol. You people are going to hell." And she marched out. Is she right? Third scenario. An elderly gentleman is an elder at a church. He's grown up in Christ. He's been a Christian for a long time. He's a huge Bible. He knows the Word almost better than everybody else in the church. He also believes, through his study and superior knowledge, that drums are of the devil. A young man, a musician, gets saved out of a life of drugs and rock and roll and living a hard life. And in fact, he felt his drumming needed to be set aside for a little while because, well, it had taken him places that he knew wasn't good. But after he became a Christian, he thought, "How can I serve the Lord?" And he read in a magazine one day that there was worship teams where the Christians were all former band members of rock and roll bands, and he said, I want to use my gifting to serve the Lord. And he didn't tell anybody about this. But the elderly gentleman said, there's a new young family in the church. I'm going to invite him over to do my Christian duty and have everyone in the house with some fellowship. And as they began to talk, he found out that this young man played drums. And he says to him, young man, you are right to put drums away from you. However, if you ever pick them up again, or if you ever bring them into the church, they'll never come back, and they'll be going to hell. Those are hard scenarios, aren't they? And yet legalism is so attractive to so many of us, because it's hard to believe that Jesus really did pay for all of my sins. It feels like if I'm a little bit better, if I'm a little bit, you know, following God's rules, then he's going to love me just a little bit more, or perhaps even give me the things that I want. Legalism, it runs sometimes in our flesh, and you know what the funny thing is? Legalistic people don't know they're legalistic. They don't think they are. But it's a struggle. And in every church, there are people on either side of the spectrum. You have your ultra-right Orthodox folks who say, the Bible says it, I believe it, I don't do it. No one else should either. And then you have this other side, I call them the hippie free spirits. That's my wife, by the way. I am the ultra-right, she's the hippie on the left. She eats vegetables I've never heard of in my life. She's always wanted me to be organic and free-range and stuff like that. That's why we go together so well. But this group doesn't struggle with legalism at all. In fact, they don't like anything to do with it. They just want to love people. This group has a lot of knowledge about the Word. This group just wants to love people. And it comes together sometimes and creates conflict. Did you know that every church is perfect until we get here? There is a group of people that I can neither identify with nor do I understand them in any way. Vegetarians. I'm not talking about the ones that, like, you know, like, hey, I eat because of my diet, or because I got a health problem, and I eat vegetables, and this is why. No, that I understand. Like, cross-cutters that do that, okay, that I understand. What I don't understand is the ones that seem to have a moral objection to meat, and yet they kill thousands of innocent things. I'm joking, of course. But you've seen maybe on TV or perhaps even known somebody who has a moral objection to eating meat, and because they have the conviction that it's wrong, they also think that no one else should eat meat either. And there's this holier-than-thou arrogance almost that rises up and says that you people are wrong because you're doing this wrong stuff, and I'm right because I'm doing this, and you're just not as enlightened as me, and there's a division. And you know what? It creeps into the church. It happens. And this is what Paul is going to do with today. The Apostle Paul is going to speak to us in this matter, beginning in verse 1, 1 Corinthians chapter 8. He says, now concerning things offered to idols, we know that all have knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. And if anyone thinks that he knows anything, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, this is known by him. So he begins now with this thing. It's not something we struggle with, because it doesn't really happen in our society, but in these days, it was a huge deal. So in order to understand what he's getting at here, in order to place it in the context that we need it, we have to transport ourselves back to Corinth, back to Paul's day, and understand why this is such an issue. Because, in fact, he's answering another question. The question that he's answering here is, what about meat that's been sacrificed to an idol? How should the Christian relate to this subject? Right? Because as a Christian, I'm the light of the world. I've been called to love God and love people. I want to reach out, and I want to, you know, not be of the world, but be in the world, but not of the world. And so I want to reach out to non-believers, and sometimes that's having fellowship. What if they serve me for trust? They've been offered to an idol. What do I do? So they ask the Apostle Paul. Now, in these days, they were temples all over Corinth. Corinth was known as Sin City, man. And not only that, but they had gods for everything. And there were these massive temples there, and what they would often do is they would offer up animals to their idol, whatever it is, Zeus, Mercury, Athena, they had all these different gods. In fact, they had so many gods that they actually had a monument that they wrote on there to the unknown god, just in case they missed it. Paul used this in Rome to give the gospel to the people. He says, hey, you know this unknown god? Let me tell you about the one you don't know about. This is the God that created everything. He uses it to share the gospel. But this is how many gods they had in Corinth. And the priests that worked in the temple, when a sacrifice was brought, now the sacrifice itself would be divided up three ways. Some of it was given to the god. It was burnt as an offering to the god. And usually that was like the fur, the skin, the entrails, the things they didn't really want. They would offer that to the god, right? And then the second portion went to the priest, usually the good cuts, the T-bones, that sort of thing. And then the rest of it went to the person that offered it. So you sort of had two ways. But what if you're a priest, and in one day you made eight sacrifices, two of them were oxen, and, you know, the others were goats and sheep and what have you. Man, you got a lot of meat, and that's in one day's work. So what would they do? They had a side hustle going on. They would take that meat, and they would put it in the marketplace, and they would sell it. And some of the temples themselves had something that we might look at as a food court or a restaurant. And they took this meat, and they cooked it up, right? So it was a good day to go out to eat that day if they're sacrificing a meal. You got the good stuff. Let's go to Zeus's house of worship for steak tonight. Steak night, or Taco Tuesday, whatever it is that they had going on. So there was a lot of idol meat out in the community. And it was a little bit cheaper than doing it yourself. So, you know, what happened? You got a bunch of friends over, you weren't quite ready, go down to Walmart, you pick up some meat to sacrifice to an idol, a little bit cheaper down there, get it in bulk, bring it back, and we're all good. But what if you're a Christian and this meat has been sacrificed to an idol? There's a problem. So before even addressing whether it's right or wrong into doing that, Paul, he addresses us, and he lays down, rather, a principle. He says, we know that we all have knowledge, but knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. He says, before we even dig into this idea of whether or not it's right or wrong, I want you to understand something. Knowledge puffs up. You know what it means to puff up? You ever see like Rice Krispies, right? Or puffed rice? You know, it gets bigger, but it doesn't change the substance at all. It's still a piece of rice. It just looks bigger because it's full of something, right? And this is indicative, the knowledge that puffs up, of one who has a lot of knowledge about God but doesn't really love people. This is a person who knows more scriptures than the Bible, has got scripture for everything, but usually gives it with a wagging finger and applying it to everybody else. Don't do this, don't do this, or you should do this, you should do this. A lot of knowledge, but not very much love. You know what that is? Knowledge without love is mean. On the other side of that, though, you have love without knowledge. One who doesn't really know the Bible that well, but wants to love everybody, ends up being a hypocrite. Because love then begins to take on the definition that you want it to take on, right? If I'm loving to somebody, then I would never address their sin, but get offended over that. Well, that's not loving. Right? If I'm loving to somebody, well, then they can do drugs in my house. No, that's not loving. That's enabling. It's loving to share the truth with love. So the Christian, to mature in Christ, needs to be balanced, having the knowledge of God, but also balanced out with the love of God. Because the more time you spend with God, you will begin to love him more, and then you begin to love other people because God is love. And so the more time you spend with him, you will end up doing that. But it's important to have both. Otherwise, knowledge just puffs up. Otherwise, it's just a head with no friends. Otherwise, it's just a person with a lot of friends, but hypocritical. So he lays down this principle, and I love it. Paul, verse 2 is one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible. He says, if anyone thinks that he knows anything, he knows nothing, yet is yet to know. In other words, he says, oh, you're a know-it-all, huh? You don't know anything. That's literally what he writes here. I just updated it to modern English. There were those in the church that said, oh, I already know, I've already ruled, I've already heard, I already understand. And he's like, yeah, you guys don't really know anything. Love is the driving factor for your decisions. Love should be driving you toward relationships. The whole Bible's about relationships. God has a relationship with men, us. He wants a relationship personal with you. And in that relationship, God begins to change you, and it begins to affect all of your other relationships. The problem is, when we begin to follow what we believe is right, and we have it so much, that we sacrifice our relationships. That's why we started with a question. Are you going to be right? or is the relationship the most important? So Paul lays down this principle. Before we even get too far, I want to read to you from the book of Acts, chapter 15, because no doubt there's a couple of Bible scholars in here that say, well, wait a second, the Jerusalem Council said, so let's read what they wrote. First of all, I want you to understand, there was a problem when the church age began. As the Apostle Paul went out and he was planting churches, there was a group that went behind him that was beginning to tell all of the Gentiles that in order to be a Christ follower, they needed to first become Jewish and follow the law. All the Old Testament laws, dietary restrictions, sacrifices, new moon, season, Sabbath, all that kind of stuff. They needed to go and do all of that, and they needed to get circumcised. Now, every Gentile perked up and thought, you want me to what? You want me to, excuse me? So this was a problem that led to, and Paul took the side and was like, wait a minute, we can't make the Gentiles do something that we Jews were raised in and we couldn't even do. Look at our history, he would say. It's awful. We can't put this on the Gentiles. They weren't raised in this stuff. There's no way they can follow along. So it comes to this Jerusalem Council. This is the very first, what you might call, elders meeting that we see in the Bible. This is all the uppity-ups, the pastors of all the places, the original disciples. Here they come together, beginning of verse 2, chapter 15. It says, then please the apostles and elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch with Paul, Barnabas, namely Judas, who was also Barsabbas and Silas, leading men among the brethren. They wrote this letter by them, the apostles, the elders, and the brethren. To the brethren who are of the Gentiles in Antioch, Syria, and Cilicia, this is their answer, greetings. Since we have heard that some who went out from us have troubled you with words, unsettling your souls, saying you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment, or what we didn't tell them to say that, it seemed good to us, being assembled with one accord, to send chosen men to you and our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men who have risked their lives for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have therefore sent Judas and Silas, who will also report the same things by the word of mouth. For it seemed good to us, or it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us, to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. If you one, abstain from things offered to idols. Two, from blood. That shouldn't be hard. Three, from things strangled. And four, from sexual immorality. If you keep yourself from these things, you do well. That's what they're asking. Jerusalem Council said, don't eat things sacrificed to idols. Don't eat blood. Things strangled. And sexual immorality. Stay with those four things. You ought to be able to do that, right? Now, this was for that time because the gospel was being hindered with these legalists that were coming into every church and telling these men all they had to do. So this was sort of this settle-all anger. And the Gentiles needed to learn in those days that what they needed to do was separate from the world and separate to Christ. They needed to start walking in his ways and learning to love. But then we go back to Mark chapter 7, where Jesus specifically said, after dealing with the most hypocritical Pharisees ever, he says to them, listen, you need to understand it's not what goes into the stomach which defiles man, for it just goes through the body and it's eliminated. It's just food, he says. It's what comes out of our heart that defiles man. Jesus taught this principle. So the Apostle Paul, knowing this, he's not going against the Jerusalem Council in verse 15, but rather now he's going to offer up a little bit more insight as to why they made that decision and what it really means to us. He goes on here in verse 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 8. He says, therefore, concerning the eating of the things offered to idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is no other God but one. For even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, because there are many gods and many worlds, yet for us there is one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we for him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we are all through whom are all things, and through whom we live. So, what did you do? Okay, let's talk about this thing about the sacrifice of the idol of meat. This is what Paul says. Let me summarize for you. Hey, look, it's just a pork chop. It's just a steak. He says there are no such things. Zeus doesn't really exist. You see the movie Wizard of Oz? Right? They got the big talking head. I am the great and powerful Oz. And then somebody walks behind the curtain and is like, it's just a guy back here. Pulling strings. That's it. Zeus doesn't really exist. There is no other God, he says. There's the one true God. And then you have demons that pose themselves as God, and people worship them, and it always has something to do with worshiping my own personal wants and desires. Every God throughout history, you ever look at them, you go back and research some of these things. And I say that hesitantly because you can go overboard in this. The Bible never tells us to go and research demons. The Bible never tells us to put our focus on them at all. But we acknowledge they exist. Right? But these gods that have existed throughout history, every single one of them is worshipped. The God is only a greater version of myself, and through worshiping this God, I just worship myself. It's through sexual morality, it's through getting stuff, it's through money, it's always as a worshiping me. This is what these gods are. He's like, they don't really exist, they're just images, they're figures of people's imagination. But the one true God, he's the one that exists. All things were created through him, we exist for him, and the Lord Jesus Christ saved us from all this stuff. We're saved, we're loved, we're going to heaven, it's just a pork chop. In chapter 10, he's going to say, look, if somebody invites you over to over their dinner, you go to their house, and they bring out a wonderful rack of lamb. He says, let's follow one policy. Don't ask, don't tell. Just eat it. They made it. They cooked it. They brought you over. The relationship with the person that they would come to Christ, this is what's really important, not the food. The food is just something that's on the table. Now, if you find out, if they say, yes, this was sacrificed to my favorite idol, in fact, by eating it, you're identifying with them, you're going to be like, okay, well, I only identify with Jesus Christ. You know, you got me tacos back there. But you don't, it's not about the food. It's not about this. You see, in these days, they thought that by eating it, you identified with the idol somehow. Like you were worshiping that idol, so a Christian should have nothing to do with it. I mean, I'm telling you, we could apply this to so many areas within the church. Christmas, yoga, right? All these kinds of things, and sure, you know, if God has personally convicted you on some of these things, and you're like, you know what? I can't get involved in that. I don't like where it came from. I don't like what it represents. I'm going to just worship Jesus, and I'm going to do that. Wonderful. But don't think you're more holy than everybody else, because that's your choice. Right? It's true. Everybody's got room to grow. Everybody's got the grace of Lord Jesus Christ. You can't get mad at another sheep because he doesn't run or is able to keep up with the flock as well as you can. The relationship is important. You know those scenarios I gave you in the very beginning? Apply those scenarios now to what we just learned. Is it really about drums? Is it really about other people drinking? Because I would submit to you in that same scenario, I did say this to the person. Wow, how many conversations did you have about Jesus with those who weren't drinking? You didn't because you left. And you made such a scene about it that everybody thinks that's a loving Christian now. Right? Could have just got it quietly. You could have made a lot of different choices, but you didn't. The original one, I'm going to come back to the first scenario at the end, but I think, that's tough. She finally got her husband to church. She heard about Jesus, and she heard about drinking, felt justified, and left. Ah! Why? What about the, you know, two men arguing? Was it worth it? That's what I would love to ask. If I were to talk to an elder that made that kind of decision, what I would ask him is it worth it? Are you happy because you won the argument? Because you totally justified the drum sitting along in church and you put this guy out and now he's never going to come back and he's going to get right back into drumming and perhaps even walk away from Jesus? Was it worth it? You lost the relationship. You were right. Maybe. How many people are sitting on their own little I'm right island without any relationships around it because I'm right. You shouldn't do this, or you should do this, and I know this, and I had this argument, and I told them, and I got off, and I'm right, and I'm sitting right over here, but you don't have any relationships, though. You're just sitting over here on your arm right island. You're just talking to yourself. You feel totally justified. I'm happy for you, but you're not doing anything. And you lost them. And you know what? In the church, if you lose somebody out of the church, out of a fight or an argument, oftentimes they never come back. You know the number one reason people say they don't want to go to church is hypocrisy. That's the number one reason. Like the pastor gets up and rails about drinking and then they see him in the bar getting hammered, right? That's always the scene that we fall back. You know, unfortunately, in the last several years, there have been a lot of sexual immorality cases involving pastors and it's brought shame and a reason for the enemies of Christ to rejoice and blaspheme. Yeah, but that's the number one reason. And so all these relationships are lost. And so he says, look, it's just me. It's just me, man. It doesn't matter. It's not sacrifice. Now, if I just stopped right here, you have two groups in the church now. Right? You got one group that says, Jerusalem Council said not to. It's black and white. I won't do it. And anybody who does it is going against the word of God. Maybe they don't even love Jesus now because of this. And then you got the group on the other side that's saying, Bible says there's no such thing, man. We can go and eat at the restaurant at Jesus' place right now. It's not a big deal. We all have liberty and love, and we're all good. And the two sides would never be friends, right? Not without Jesus anyway. Because they're at odds. So this is where Paul is going to bring it down to the real application, and he's going to really just sort of bring us back down to earth and say, okay, look, maybe you're right, maybe you're right, but let's look at this through another lens that I want you to apply to every situation from this point forward. Verse 7, he says, however, there is not in everyone the knowledge. For some, with consciousness of the idol until now, eat it as a thing offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food does not commend us to God, for neither if we eat it are we better, nor if we don't eat it are we the worse. But beware. This is a part. When you see beware, underline. But beware lest somehow this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to those who eat. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple, will not the conscience of him who is weak be emboldened to eat those things offered to idols? And because of your knowledge, shall the weak brethren perish for whom Christ died? But when you thus sin against the brethren, you wound the weak conscience, you actually sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I'll never eat meat again, lest my brother stumble. Hey, what Paul's saying here? What's he saying here? What's really important? Now, he's talking about something that's specifically a challenge for some people. I'm going to use alcohol as an example because it's kind of a big topic in the church. People are passionate about both sides. I've never quite understood. But people are passionate. Now, in my previous life as a fireman, I just freely admit to you, we didn't do anything without beer. In fact, we even had rules sometimes that when we got together with things, you had to have a beer with an animal on it. It was a stupid game that we played. Right? And I abused it many times. I had way too much many times. The Bible doesn't say, not drink, it does say a lot about drunkenness, and I broke that law plenty of times. But when I became a Christian, there was something deep inside of me that says, you know what? I've got you here at the fire department, and everybody's doing this, and it's harmful to some of them. God convicted me on my own personal drinking and said, if we're going to be an example here, then we need to set the example here and set this aside. And so I did. And you know, we went back and forth for a few times, and sometimes I had one, and I tried to do the thing where you just hold one, and everybody else drinking, so they quit bothering you, which never works, because even drunk people know you're not drinking when you're just holding on to it. And everybody says something, it's worse, because you still have to answer, you know, no, I'm only holding this one beer because I'm a Christian. What do you hold the beer for? And so God called me to step that aside. But later on in ministry, I was faced with the question, is it right for a pastor to drink it or not drink it? Because the words in 1 Timothy are clear. A pastor is not to be given to alcohol. But the word given is always sort of up to this interpretation in gray area. There are pastors who argue vehemently that Paul didn't never said that pastors should not drink it, that cannot touch it, and there's, you know, so they hold on to this idea that, you know what, you just turn water into wine, I have the liberty, I'm going to drink. And then you have this other side, the right side, extreme right side that says, no, a pastor should have nothing to do with it. It's not good. If he drinks it, yeah, blah, 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 blah. So there's these two sides to the argument. You know what I say? Both, to me, are irrelevant. Why? Because I figured this, that if I'm going to be an example, then I should set the example by my actions. Not only that, but I counsel people who struggle with alcohol. There are people who come into the church where this is a big deal. And you know what they're looking for? They're looking for somebody to set the example of a life that lives without it. And I say, I should be that example. So if somebody struggles with it, how bad would it be if he showed up to, and he happens to walk past the bar and look in, and there I am eating peanuts and drinking beer, and I've got three in me already, and I'm already starting to, you know, and then he walks by and he's like, well, Pastor Aaron can do it. That's good for me then. I'm going to come in and buy him a beer. But then he goes down this road of alcoholism of which he could never get out. So my Christian liberty being right caused him to stumble. And if I lose him for good, what have I gained? Why is it good for me to drink then? What has alcohol ever brought into my life? None. So for me, the biblical reason for drinking, whether it's right or it's wrong, is irrelevant. To me, if it causes a brother to stumble, then I will never again have a beer in my refrigerator. And I've made that choice for me, and I've asked the pastors who get ordained here to make that same choice. It's done. It's over. You can't be your last drink. You're going to be here. Wonderful. Don't drink. Now, for the church, I say, you've got liberty. Don't abuse it. Be careful. If it becomes an issue, then you need to do it. But listen, I'm not going to be the reason why somebody stumbles. That's my personal choice. And that's, I believe, the heart of Paul's saying here. Do you want to be right? Or do you want to have the relationship? Because if you lose the relationship, you know what else you lose? The ability to speak into their life from this point forward. And what have you gained? If you find yourself sitting on your own little I'm right island, what have you gained? You might be right. Maybe you won the argument. Maybe you told them a thing or two. But now you're by yourself. What if you were to set aside that which you believe is right for you for the benefit of loving somebody else? What have you been given? A relationship? A brother or a sister? Possibly a new convert in heaven? Going back, this is what Paul said, knowledge pops up, but love edifies. And one who loves is known by God. Love is our deciding factor. That is the filter by which our decisions are made. When traditions or rules or thou shalt not or thou shalt get in the way and it begins to result in loss of relationship, you've lost the essence of Christ. You've lost the essence of the Bible. And you're just a clanging cymbal walking around with a lot of knowledge but not very much. Let us never become that. Because you know what happens to churches that begin to elevate rules up to the part of importance that people leave over? It becomes a museum for saved people. Ultimately, will result in being a monument of Christianity. But the church that sees love as its highest priority in reaching people, coupled with the truth of God, will be a hospital for the sick that people will be attached to, even if you're in the back corner of the room. I leave you with this question that we began with. Are you more interested in being right or more interested in keeping the relationship? My hope for you is that you choose relationships. Now, there are things to be right over. Primary issues. Salvation. God exists. Those things you know. Primary issues and secondary issues. My hope is that as you begin to choose relationships, God fills you with more joy and blessing in your heart than you ever imagined. That your relationships are blessed, that the essence of Christ is poured out upon you, and that you shine as a light and a beacon in a dark world that always places itself on the relationship. Father, I thank you, Lord, for today's time that you have spoken to us, Lord, this morning from your scriptures. Lord, I do pray, Lord, that you will guide us, that you will show us, Lord, in our hearts, where we harbor this bitterness. Maybe even if there's a snidge, a